हेलो, वेलकम टू द न्यू सेशन ऑन यार्न डबलिंग एंड वी शैल बी स्टार्टिंग टुडे अ न्यू टॉपिक एंड वी विल स्टडी द रिलेशन बिटवीन वेरियस फैक्टर्स दैट अफेक्ट यार्न प्रॉपर्टीज और द डबल्ड यार्न प्रॉपर्टीज रादर. सो लेट अस सी द प्राइमरी एम ऑफ यार्न डबलिंग. यार्न डबलिंग इज अ प्रोसेस ऑफ कंबाइनिंग टू और मोर यार्न्स बाय ट्विस्टिंग देम टुगेदर. यार्न डबलिंग इज डन विथ मेजरली टू ऑब्जेक्टिव्स. To attain a particular physical characteristic that cannot be obtained with a single yarn of similar count as that of the plied yarn. So, if you want to improve or introduce certain physical characteristics, special characteristics other than those given by the single yarn, we need to go for yarn doubling. Doubling is also used for the production of designed effects in yarns, but this involves a specialist type of doubling to produce what are called as fancy yarns. So this topic of fancy yarns we shall study after we study doubling. In case of producing fancy yarns, there has to be certain different types of production methods which will introduce the designed effects in the yarn, and we shall see them later. Twist direction and plying and cabling, we shall see look at all these terms and understand what they actually mean. So here what we see is a twist direction. When the fibers on the surface are laid in the Z direction, we can see it is known as a Z twist, and if they are laid in this manner, it is called as S twist. We look at the middle portion of Z, which is inclined in this manner, and we name it accordingly. For S, it is the other way around. So Z and S twist can be formed in ring spinning, but only Z twist in open end spinning. Now, since we already know all the different types of spinning or alternative spinning methods. We also know that in open end spinning, we can only have Z twist, whereas ring spinning can give us both types of twists. Airjet yarns as such do not have any true conventional twist. However, MJS machines, that is Murata Jet, are offered in both S and Z fiber wrap directions. So let us also try and see how this twist directions are very important to us, especially when we go for manufacture of fabric, which is the downstream process after the yarn is made. So if the twill direction in the fabric is opposite from the twist direction in the yarn, the twill line will be raised more on the fabric surface. This we have seen when we go for a twill fabric. Also, if the twist direction in the yarn is opposite to the rotational direction of knitting machine. Now, in case of knitting machine, if the twist direction is opposite, then it tends to produce fabrics with less torque or skew. So, with this background that how important twist directions as well as the twist amounts which we'll see later, these are certain factors which are very important when we go for using the yarns in the downstream process. So during spinning, care must be taken to see what kind of yarn we are expecting in the downstream processes. So having seen this, let us go to the plying and doubling, and let us understand the nomenclature that is given over here. 2x40s, that is when, suppose this is singles yarn, and this is 40 single yarn, we are taking two singles yarn and we are plying them. So this particular plied yarn would be called as 2x40s any. So 2x40s any represents two single yarns of English count 40s when they are twisted together to get a resultant. Now the resultant is written as like this: 2, which is the number of plies that are used, and 40 is the count of the single yarn. So this is how we represent plied yarns. So 2x2x40s would mean that two single yarns of 40 are first doubled, that is this situation. And such two yarns, doubled yarns, would then be again be doubled, or rather it is called as cabled, and you get a 2x2x40s resultant yarn. So this is how plied or a cabled yarn is represented. In case of filament yarns, it's slightly different. It is 2x150x34, means that two 150 denier yarns are plied together and each contains 34 filaments. So having seen this, let us see why cabling would be done. For certain special purposes, a third twisting operation may be needed involving a combination of two or more plied yarns that we have just seen how it is done. The process is then known as cabling. An example would be in special cases where sewing threads are made, in which the structure is required to have maximum strength combined with the minimum irregularity and stretch. In such a case, one will have to go for a cabling which would provide all these properties that are required in the final application. So let us see the systems for producing this doubler packages or the doubled yarn. To produce doubled yarn, what are the processes that we need to go through? The first type is the single process system. Once the ring bobbins are made on ring spinning, then these ring bobbins are used directly as a supply package for doubler winding. Now between ring spinning and twisting or doubling or getting the twisted doubled yarn, there is one more process which is known as the doubler winding, which is in between. For this doubler winding, one of the processes which is known as single process system, where directly the ring bobbins are used. Now there is one more system which is a two process system, where the singles yarns, that means the ring bobbins, are first wound on a cone winder. That means you will get a big package. This will also clear all the slubs and other imperfections, and then these cones are fed to the doubler winding. So you can have a single process a preparation system, or you can have a two process preparation system for the doubler winding. And once this in the two process system, the advantage over the single process is that there's an opportunity to clear all the faults and obtain a bigger package that can be run at higher speeds. Now since all the faults are cleared, such bigger packages coming from a two process system could be run at a higher speed of 400 meters per minute and above on the doubler winder or the assembly winder. So when you take such packages and you go further, you can go for final twisting on a doubling machine. So let us see the flow chart. Production of a doubled yarn in a two-stage process, assembling and twisting, that is performed by different machines. Some modern machines perform both the functions of assembling and twisting at one in one stage or one go. So either ring bobbins, as we've just seen, are directly taken from the assembly winder and then twisted, and this is known as a single process system. So in a single process system, this is just shown in the form of a flowchart that we have just discussed. Ring bobbin is taken, it goes to the doubler winding machine, or which is also known as, preferably I would call it an assembly winder because it creates less confusion. So ring bobbin is taken on an assembly winder to get a package with ends wound together parallel to each other but yet not twisted. So you'll get a package where the whatever plies you want to twist together in the final doubled yarn, you'll just put them together parallelly wound on this particular package which is coming from the assembly winder. And then finally you get to take this assembly wound package, take it to the doubling machine and get it twisted. So you can also, in the double process system, this is how it goes. Ring bobbins are first wound individually by the winding process before being taken for assembly winding and later for twisting. So you will have one more stage here, that is a ring bobbin is taken. First it is going for winding, and then it goes for a doubler winding or an assembly winder to get a package similar as earlier, which is shown here. So you get a parallel a package with ends wound parallel to each other but yet not twisted, and this such a package is then just like before, it is taken for doubling. So let us just see how a doubler winding machine or the assembly winder looks like, or how what is the passage, etc. For this, the purpose of an assembly winder is to unite two or more ends on a package before twisting. So this is how it is done. Two packages, suppose it is a two stage system where you'll get two big packages which are taken and they are passed through a tensioning device and a stop motion, and it goes and it forms a parallel wound package like this, where two ends are just taken parallel to each other and simply wound. So this kind of a system, it guarantees uniform tension on all the yarns that shall be twisted subsequently. So before the final twisting, it ensures that in each of these ends there is a uniform tension that is applied, and also the defects arising due to ununiform tension in the component yarn, which is called as a corkscrew, which is a very which is a very common defect which is found in a doubled yarn. So such a defect is avoided. In addition to these advantages, it eliminates the possibility of dropped ply. That means dropped ply means one or more single yarns are missing during twisting in the next process. That is during doubling. Sometimes it's found that one of the yarns is missing, and this possibility can completely be eliminated by having this assembly winder in between your ring spinning and doubling machine. So a doubler winding machine or the assembly winding machine would look something like this. And what we see is the doubler winding machine in a two process system is fed by packages of yarn. So you can see the bigger packages that are being fed, generally pre-cleared. That means they are free of faults, and they are placed in the lower section of the machine, and they pass through the yarn tensioning devices to maintain uniform tensions on the yarn, which and this package will be later on taken for doubling. The machine has a separate tensioning device and stop motion for each individual yarns. So whatever yarns you are taking for parallel winding, each of them will have a separate tensioning as well as a stop device, so that you can get rid of both these faults that might arise during final doubling. That is, first one was corkscrew, which will be taken care of when you apply uniform tension, or when you give two separate tensioning devices where you can maintain equal tensions in both of them. And then to eliminate the possibility of drop ply, we have separate stop motions, so that whenever the end breaks, the machine will stop, and this possibility of drop ply is completely eliminated. So this assembly winder is a very important preparation step for the doubling machine. Such an assembly wound package shall be creeled on the doubling or the twisting machine. So assembly winding, or a doubler winder in short, it is a preparatory process, and doubling is the final process in the production of doubled yarn, also known as, now this doubled yarn is also termed or known as folded yarn or plied yarns. So dry and wet doubling are two main styles of doubling, and may be carried out to alter the final resultant yarn properties for different end purposes. So in doubling also there are, they can be classified as dry doubling and wet doubling. These are the two main styles. In dry doubling, it is very simple. The assembly wound package is simply taken and twisted by using maybe a ring and traveler system or a 2-for-1 twister, which we will see the different types of doubling methods later on. But there are basically two styles. One is dry doubling and the second one is wet doubling. And may be carried out to alter the final yarn properties. So we shall now see how this wet doubling is done, and how it is able to influence the final yarn properties. So wet doubled yarns are harder, stronger, and more wiry. The protruding fibers get embedded in the yarn body, giving a better appearance to the resultant doubled yarn. The wet doubled yarns are less hairy. Wet doubling can be classified into different styles of threading. Now, wet doubling itself, you can thread in many different ways to get different types of wet doubling. So, wet doubling classification, let us see the each type that is available. English or Stockport style of wet doubling. In this, this is the passage of yarn that is there. The yarn is going through a trough filled with water, and it is coming out, and this is the way it is being passed through the calendar rollers. So wet doubling is carried out by drawing the ends through a trough containing special solutions of plain water before twisting. The yarn from the creel is made to pass under a glass rod immersed in water trough. Now this is a glass rod which is immersed in the water trough. Usually the water troughs are made of copper. Now this trough would be made up of copper with water inlet and outlet pipe arrangement. There is no chance of slippage, but the yarn might suffer great friction, surface friction, because it is going through these rollers later on. Let us see something known as a modified Stockport style of wet doubling. Here it's a similar passage, but instead of going from the bottom roller first and then coming out of the top roller, here the passage is slightly changed. It is going over the top roller first and then going below the bottom roller. So here too, there is a minimum chance of slippage that we can see. Then we come to the Scotch style of wet doubling, where this is the passage where the rollers are themselves are the ones that are going to squeeze are themselves immersed in the trough of water. So best sewing threads are made using this style of threading. Water has a better opportunity to penetrate in the yarn body. As you can see, the yarn is able to absorb more water because it is going to be in the water for a longer period of time, and you are giving a more better opportunity for the water to penetrate into the yarn body. Here the yarn is wetted first and then squeezed to remove the excess water. So it is wetted and then it will be squeezed between these two rollers, and you'll get a doubled yarn. After this, it will go for twisting. First, it will go through this. The passage is like this. The assembly wound package is there, which is going through this, whatever passage we have just seen, different types. And then it will go for further for twisting. A hollow brass roller. Now, this is a brass roller of 2.5 inches diameter, is placed in a trough. It is partially submerged, as you can see. The yarn finally passes over the grooved glass rod, each groove being approximately placed over corresponding spindle, which carries out twisting. So this is a glass rod which would be grooved, and each groove will provide a passage to the yarn to each corresponding spindle, which would be carrying out the twisting. So we come to the next system of threading for wet doubling, that is American system, and here this is how the passage goes. First, the yarn will go through the calendar rollers, get squeezed to remove all the air that is there in the within the yarn structure, and then it is getting wetted. In this system, the yarn is first squeezed and passed and then passed through the water. The roller will always remain dry and will not get soiled or dirty. Like in the previous cases, they were squeezed, either squeezed later or the roller themselves were placed in the trough. In this case, the rollers are placed earlier in the passage so that they do not get dirty or they do not even get wet. Disadvantages are that the yarn does not have a good opportunity to absorb the water before being twisted to give a folded yarn. So before being twisted, which is the next passage here, the yarn does not have a good opportunity to absorb any water. Also, the roller grip is less stronger than that in the Scotch system. So we come to the next style, that is known as the Nottingham style of doubling. In this, the yarn passes through the water first and then it will go in this manner. It will go through the roller nip, return back, go around the glass rod here, and then again it is passed through the nip. So that means the yarn is passing through the roller nip twice. The yarn after wetting is fed through the nip between top and bottom delivery roller and then passed over the top roller. It curves around the glass rod and is again led once again through the nip between the top and bottom delivery rollers, which then passes to the twisting zone. The yarn passes twice through the nip of the rollers, and the top roller needs to be light. In this case, we need to see that the top roller is very light. Due to the high chance of slippage, this style is recommended for fine counts with low doubling twist. So let us see the factors that affect the doubled yarn properties. The doubled yarn properties are affected by the style of doubling, that is whether we have used a wet or a dry doubling system, and the direction of a twist in the component as well as the resultant yarn. The direction, whether it is S or Z, both in component as well as the resultant yarn would affect the yarn properties. And also the amount of twist in the single as well as a doubled yarn would also affect yarn properties. So we'll see each one of them, how they affect each other, how each factor decides the yarn properties that is there, or rather for a certain application, if we need certain yarn properties, how we can engineer them so that we get the right yarns for the right application. So, direction of twist in the component yarn and resultant yarn. Let us see how this works out. The single yarns are generally Z twisted. So, normally whatever yarns we get on ring spinning system, it is Z twisted. And the normal doubled yarn would be S twisted. So, it is S over Z, and they are represented in this manner. S, that's a doubling twist, and Z is the twist in the singles yarn. Or it can also be written as S over Z into Z, where you are actually showing the number of plies also. Here two yarns, Z-twisted yarns are taken and plied to get one single S-twisted double yarn. Such yarns are stable and have fullness, are smooth and are also lustrous. Plying with the S on Z twist produces a double yarn or plied yarn in which the fibers in the constituent singles appear to lie approximately parallel to the plied yarn axis. It means that when you are plying in this direction, that means the plying twist you are giving in the opposite direction to that of the singles. So it might so happen, or rather it happens that the twist in the singles is removed to a large extent because of the opposite twisting which is happening during doubling. And therefore, the fibers in the constituent singles would get opened out and they would be lying more or approximately more parallel to the plied yarn axis. And because of this, this gives the plied yarn a more smooth and lustrous appearance than a single yarn, which might be able to give the kind of luster. The double yarn would provide more luster because of the opening out of the twist in the singles, and since they're lying much more parallel to the yarn axis. The S-ply twist, instead of adding to the Z-twist in the single yarn, balances it. That means since the single yarn has got Z and we are twisting it is in the opposite direction, the two twists will balance themselves, and with a suitable ratio approximately of 2/3, we can have a very stable plied yarn, and we shall see the details in the coming slides. For special effects, sometimes Z over Z is also used in some cases like voile and crepe when they are produced. At that time, Z over Z is also used. Such yarns are unstable, harsh, rough, and have a high tendency to snarl. Now, snarling means that snarly yarns have a strong tendency to twist around itself if held in the untensioned state, since they are very, very twist lively. So, it would be like this. If this is a non-twist lively yarn, where if you just hold them, they do not twist amongst each other. Whereas here you see that it is very, very twist lively. It twists upon itself. And you can see more the snarling, this length from here to here would be more. You can also maybe count the number of twists that it takes. More the number means more is the snarling tendency. So such yarns are also made for special applications like voile and crepe. So let us come to this, understand this term, something known as a D by S ratio, which is very important. D by S ratio means doubling twist multiplier divided by single twist multiplier, which can be shortly written as D by S. Let us consider three cases one by one. First, let us see the first case where we are just assuming that the singles yarn is say 2/16, which is now we are making a S over Z twisted yarn. Therefore, the singles yarn count would be 16 and the doubled yarn count would be 8 because it becomes coarser after doubling. The calculation of this, how it is done, we shall see in the lecture later on. So in this case, we are trying to keep D is as equal to S. So doubling twist multiplier and single twist multiplier, both let us keep it as 4 and see how the calculation works. So doubled yarn TPI would be 4, which is a twist multiplier, TM root of count, that is a doubled yarn count is 8. So we get doubled yarn TPI is 11.3. And since it is S twisted double yarn, I get S twisted TPI as 11.3. Coming to the single yarn TPI, it is twist multiplier is again 4. Since we have tried to keep it equal, this is a case where we are keeping D is equal to S. So 4 root 16, which is the singles count. And what we get is a TPI is 16, but in the Z direction. So TPI in the doubled yarn is 11.3 S twisted, and that remaining in the single yarn after doubling would be 4.7 Z. So if you see that doubled yarn, if you we assume that each twist on the doubled yarn would remove one twist from the single yarn, so this 11.3 twists are inserted in the opposite direction in the S in the singles, and the difference would be 4.7. And still, since single yarn has got more twist than the doubled yarn, some twist will still remain, that is 4.7 Z twisted will remain in the singles. And this happens when we are keeping a D by S ratio as 1. So since there are very few turns of twist left in the single yarn, such a yarn would be soft and poor in strength, but will retain much of its luster. So such a yarn would be soft and poor, but will retain its luster, and such yarns would give maximum cohesion. Coming to the second case or the type where D by ratio we change, and let us see how it works. So the same parameters we are keeping. Here we are keeping D less than S, that means doubling twist multiplier is 3, say, and then we keep single twist multiplier same as before, that is 4. So let us see the calculation again the same way, TM root count, and we get these values. So we see that TPI in the doubled yarn is 8.4, which is again lesser than that in the singles, and that remaining in the singles. So when you take the difference of this, still there would be 7.6 twists, Z twisted, remaining in the singles. So this happens when your D by S ratio is 0.75 approximately. Here the doubling turns and the residual turns in the single yarn are almost equal. So if we just see, the doubling turns is 8.4 and the twist remaining after doubling is 7.6. And such a yarn, since they are having both TPIs almost same after doubling, such a yarn would be a balanced yarn and possess sufficient strength and luster. Coming to the third type, where we try to keep D as more than S. So doubling twist multiplier as 8 and single twist multiplier as 4. We calculate in the similar manner as before. And what we see is in the doubled yarn, the TPI is more now, more than the singles. And what happens here is TPI in the doubled yarn is 22.6 and the single yarn, what would happen is it would, the single yarn, all the 16 would be removed as it is being twisted in the S direction. And still, since there are doubling TPI is still higher than 16, there is an extra 6.6 TPI which is inserted in the singles yarn, and now the singles yarn would get a S twisted S direction twist. And so in the final yarn, what we see is there is a twist in the single yarn which is 6.6 and it is in the S direction. This happens when the D by S ratio, as we see, it is 8 divided by 4, which is D by S ratio is 2. Such a yarn would naturally be high in strength. So what we see, the situation over here is now it is no more S over Z twisted doubled yarn. It has almost become a Z over Z, because in the singles yarn, in the final, it is S twisted, and a doubling twist is also S. So such S over S or Z over Z twisted yarns, which are twisted in the same direction, will always show a higher strength when compared to S over Z or oppositely twisted yarns. Here the resultant yarn would be harsh in feel with no luster, and such a yarn is also an unbalanced yarn. So this you can see that this would give you an unbalanced kind of yarn. So having seen the D by S ratio, etc., now let us see what are the how the yarn strength is affected by twist levels. So we see this graph over here, which is showing the count strength product or the CSP of the yarn against the doubling twist factor. There are three yarns that are shown: soft twisted, medium twisted, and hard twisted. So let us consider one by one. So in the graph, let us assume, let us take one single position where the doubling twist is say 8, and this is the point where it cuts all the three graphs here, and let us see how this works out. So if we were to see a soft twisted singles yarn, in a soft twisted single yarn, let us assume that doubling twist multiplier is 8 and single twist multiplier is 4. That means we can see that single twist multiplier or the twist in the singles is very much less as compared to the doubling twist multiplier here. That means it is a soft twisted singles. So doubled yarn TPI in this case would be 22.6 and singles would be 16 as before. Twist in the singles after doubling would be 6.6, that is remaining in the singles. So at the same time, now let us take a look at hard twisted singles and see how the values change. In a hard twisted single, if we keep the doubling twist multiplier as 8 and singles twist multiplier is increased to 6, so instead of having say 4 over here, we have changed it to 6. I can see there is a small mistake over here. We should keep it as 6 over here. So this would be 24. Or maybe we can keep this as 5 and see the calculation further. Maybe this you can consider as 5 over here. So doubled yarn TPI would be 22.6 and single yarn TPI would be 20 Z twisted. So twist in the singles after doubling would be 2.6 S twisted. So still you can see here that all the twist has been removed and from the singles, and it has got twisted in the 2.6 direction in the S twisted. So now when we see that, when we compare these two particular yarns, we see that the twist in the singles has reduced drastically over here, and such a yarn will have very low strength because most of the twist in the singles has disappeared. In a soft twisted single yarn, that is the first type, the yarn strength increases with increase in doubling twist. So we can see in this graph the yarn strength has kept on increasing along with the doubling twist. This happens because all the twist in the single yarn has been removed and they have been twisted in the opposite direction. So it has got twisted in the opposite direction, as we can see over here. That is which is same as the doubling twist. S twisted, both become S. In medium and high twisted singles, as the twist in the singles increases, not all twists in the singles might be removed. So this is a situation that is happening here. Since the single yarn TPI has increased over here to 20, not all of them has been removed. Some twist is still there. Twist removal has happened and some twist has been inserted, but not to a very large extent as it has been inserted here. So twisting, let alone the twisting of the singles in the S direction. So the strongest doubles yarns are produced with low singles twist. So when you have low singles twist, that means soft twisted yarns, and with high doubling twist, such yarns would give you a very, very strong doubled yarn. Higher doubling tensions also lead to higher yarn strength. So there are two factors which will affect the yarn strength. One is the twist that is there in the singles as well as doubled yarn. So low single twist with high doubling twist would give you a strong yarn. At the same time, a higher doubling tension will also give you higher yarn strength. So having seen these relations, let us see how the doubled yarn strength and extension works out for Z over Z. In case of Z over Z, even when the singles are low twisted, the resultant yarn is quite strong. Since we have seen already that they get the singles yarn would get twisted further because both the directions are the same, and such a yarn would be strong, and the production of such yarns is economical if strength is the preferred property that we are looking at. Z over Z are always stronger than S over Z when the doubling twists are less than 5. So this situation persists when you have a doubling twist which is less than 5. Also, the Z over Z yarns are more extensible but have higher contraction or take up than the corresponding S over Z yarns. Therefore, Z over Z are more likely to get affected in terms of strength and extension during subsequent processing if they are subjected to high tensions. So since these yarns are more extensible and tend to contract more, they might be the ones who are affected during the subsequent processing also. So let us see the effect of tensions during doubling. If tensions are high or low, how does it affect the yarn properties? Low tensions increase extension but affects luster and strength also in the negative way. So keeping a lower tension would mean that the strength is also negatively affected. So higher doubling tensions you can apply through higher spindle speed, heavier traveler and larger rim diameters. Such a situation would produce yarns which are stronger doubled yarns, and they would be less extensible. So with higher doubling tensions you can produce stronger doubled yarn, but they would also be less extensibility. But this is not applicable for soft twisted with low doubling twist. These are an exception. So therefore, a constant tension must be maintained during doubling, since the tension level is such an important factor that affects extension of the yarn. The relation between doubling twist and elongation at break for different twists and singles is as shown in the graph here. We are seeing a doubling twist factor against elongation at break, and these are the different graphs which are shown for different twist levels in the singles yarn. So let us see for one single yarn, that is where the twist multiplier is 3. As we go on increasing the doubling twist factor, we see that the elongation at break goes on increasing. So having seen these are the two relations, one showing tension that affects the yarn strength or elongation, and the second one which shows the twist levels that affects the elongation at break. So let us now go to see how luster and irregularity of a double yarn are affected. Highest luster and maximum strength cannot be achieved at the same doubling ratio. So these are factors which we need to consider, that you cannot get both of them at the same time. Maximum luster is obtained at 0.6, and this might not be the level where you get the highest yarn strength. So you can get either or of these properties in your final yarn. Higher doubling tension leads to improved luster and strength, even at 0.6 doubling ratio. Now let us see how the irregularity relations are there for the plied yarn. Irregularity is independent of the doubling twist, but reduces with the increase in the number of plies, which is inversely with the square root of the number of plies. The relation is like this. CV of the plied yarn is equal to CV of the single yarn divided by square root of number of single yarns in the ply. This formula must be familiar to you, and it is similar for any doubled material like slivers on the draw frame. The same formula would be applied, but instead of yarn, it would be sliver over here. Heavier travelers lead to higher irregularity. So if you use a heavier traveler, it will lead to higher irregularity. Similarly, there is one more relation which we can look at, which tells you a relation between imperfections and number of plies. So imperfections, whether it is thick, thin or neps in a ply yarn, would be equal to thick, thin or neps in the single yarn divided by number of a single ply in the single yarns in the ply raised to z, where z is 2 for thick places and neps, and it is 5 for thin places. It means that there is a greater reduction in thin places with the increase in the number of ply. So increase in number of ply would mean the denominator would increase, because for thin places it is 5 in this case. And there is a drastic, you see that there will be a reduction in the number of thin places as compared to the number of thick places as well as neps when you increase the number of plies here. So let us look at the reasons for the influence of doubling on yarn properties. Let us see a little bit deeper into the reason. So plied yarn, first let us see property, which is the plied yarn tenacity. It almost increases by 30%. So in case of S over Z yarn, the highest strength is achieved when ply, twist and spin twist. That means singles and doubles yarns are approximately equal. So if they are equal, what happens is the fibers get arranged almost parallel to the yarn axis, and which helps in making maximum use of the inherent fiber strength. Let us look at the second property, that is CSP, count strength product. And this also we see an increase by 20 to 50%, but it depends on the DS ratio and the tension during doubling. We should also note that the strength of the doubled yarn is not necessarily double that of the single yarn. You cannot exactly multiply by say 2 if you are taking a 2 ply yarn. The strength cannot be directly multiplied like that, because the irregularities in the singles are not fully compensated. That is the reason we cannot directly say that the doubled yarn would give me twice the strength of the single yarn. So this we must keep in mind. So the reason is that the increase is because of, in case of S over Z yarns, there is a reduction in the twist angle or the obliquity in the singles yarn, leading to a greater contribution of fiber strength to yarn strength. So we have seen this earlier in one of our earlier lectures, where if the fibers were to lie straight in the yarn structure, or more parallel to the yarn axis, it would contribute more towards the yarn strength. Now coming to this point, the plying S over Z or Z over Z leads to the binding in. Now this is another reason why the strength would increase, because the surface fibers are all bound into the yarn structure, leading to a greater contribution of fibers towards yarn strength. So there are two reasons why the yarn strength, as you see in total, like whether it is tenacity or CSP, both show an increase. Breaking extension is the next property. This also increases by 15 to 20%, and this happens because of averaging out of spot defects. Then you come to the Lee count variation as well as yarn strength variation, and we can see that both of these variations are reduced substantially. Objectionable faults reduced by almost 70%, and this is because we have seen that the effect of doubling will help reduce both, and this was just explained in the previous slide. So let us come to the snarling tendency. So this is the graph for snarling, and we see that the snarling length, which is shown in the x-axis, and a doubling ratio. So at low doubling twist, the snarling is influenced by twist in the single yarn. So since if we are just now, imagine that we are beginning to start twisting during doubling, and in the beginning the doubling twists are very very low. Let us say you keep it low, and what you see is it is so, therefore the snarling, if at all is there, it would be influenced by the twist in the single yarn, and it would be twisting in say one direction. And so it is snarling tendency is in the shown as a negative here, which is quite high in the beginning because of the twist in the single yarn. And as you go on, say, increasing the doubling twist, what happens is the singles yarn would open out slowly, and therefore the snarling tendency would reduce because of the lower twist that is there. And there is a point where it comes, and there may be no snarling tendency, but if you further go on increasing the doubling twist, then further on the doubling twist will take over, and at the same time the snarling twist that is there, it will start twisting in the opposite direction. And as the doubling twist is increased, the doubling twist direction dominates, and hence the snarling takes place in the opposite direction. That is the graph which is shown from B to C here. So the snarling tendency decreases as the doubling tension increases, that we have seen, and a soft twisted singles are more sensitive to singles variation. So if you want to reduce the snarling tendency, this is a trend, but if you want to reduce it, we need to increase the doubling tension so that we are able to decrease the tendency. So steaming also sometimes helps. Steam conditioning or simple wetting reduces the snarling tendency. So this also topic will be dealt with later on. So let us come to the next factor, that is yarn contraction. What is the effect of doubling twist on yarn contraction? When the yarn is twisted, it contracts in length. We know that, and the yarn becomes coarser. So also what happens is when the yarn extends, so suppose you have removed the twist, and therefore the yarn would extend. And in such a case, the actual twist in the yarn would reduce. And at the same time, if the yarn were to contract due to twisting, then the actual twist inserted would be increased apparently, because the yarn has contracted, and the twist, whatever we have inserted, because of the contraction, the actual twist that is there in the final yarn would have increased. So let us see this particular graph over here. Which is showing the relation again between doubling ratio and the actual calculated twist that is there. So in case of S over Z yarns, in the beginning, as the doubling twist is increased, the twist in the single is removed. So as you go on twisting, the twist in the singles is getting removed, and the singles yarn is getting extended. And therefore, the actual twist that is inserted, since it is getting elongated, or the singles yarn is extending in length, the actual twist inserted would be lesser and lesser, and therefore it goes in the, you can see the graph is going down, and you are having a lower doubling twist than that is expected. So as the doubling twist is increased further, as you, there's a point where your actual twist and doubling and whatever you have inserted would be same, but after a certain period, if you go on increasing the doubling twist, then the yarn starts contracting, and because of the contraction, what will happen is the actual twist in the yarn would be more than that is expected, and the graph turns in this manner from B to C. So contraction, what we can see say is that contraction due to increase in doubling twist is more than the extension due to removal of the twist in the singles. So in this particular part of the graph, this is a situation where the contraction is more due to the doubling twist as against the extension that would happen because of removal of twist in the singles yarn. So in case of Z over Z twisted yarns, there is only a contraction of a doubled yarn and the yarn would definitely become coarser. Coming to the abrasion resistance, the primary reason for sizing the worsted single yarn is not because they lack in strength, but because they are hairy. So how does this hair actually affect the downstream processes or the abrasion resistance? Let us see. Hairiness reduces the abrasion resistance since the fibers at the surface can easily be abraded away, thereby weakening the yarn. So the hairy yarn does not have the surface abrasion resistance to survive the abrasive stresses that it might be subjected to on the loom. The hair also tends to entangle with the adjacent yarn and they might cause some kind of breakages. So because of this reason, basically the yarn would be sized. So the twisting process during doubling, how does it help? The twisting process during doubling will bind the surface fibers into the yarn structure and thereby trapping them inside. So along with the increase in the strength that it provides, it will also doubling will also bind the surface fibers into the yarn structure, and because of which they will not be easily be removed from the yarn surface due to abrasion, which will result in an improvement in the abrasion resistance of the resultant yarn. So this is the relation between hairiness of the yarn and the abrasion resistance. So let us see the sort of summary on the improvements of the yarn properties due to doubling. But the first property that we see yarn uniformity has been improved. There is also an improvement in abrasion resistance due to better binding in of the surface fibers. We have reduced yarn hairiness. Balancing of the untwisting torque takes place in the single yarn. If the doubling is carried out correctly, we can have a good balanced yarn. Tenacity is improved due to the more axial orientation of fibers and therefore better utilization of fiber properties. We see that singles yarn twist is opened out and the fibers get oriented more towards the axis of the yarn, and because of the better utilization of fiber properties, we might see an increase in the or an improvement in the tenacity. Also, higher yarn volume and resultant improvement in fabric cover we can have by modifying certain fiber arrangements. Also, modified specific handle and visual appearance can be introduced in the doubled yarn. But we must keep in mind that doubled yarns are generally more expensive than the single yarns of the same count because of two reasons. The first reason is very obvious, that we have introduced an extra process there which is involved in doubling. But other than this, what happens is the single yarn used for producing the doubled yarn are also more costly to produce. To produce the same count of say singles yarn which we would have normally produced, to produce a doubled yarn, I will have to have two singles yarn which are finer in count, and to produce this finer count singles yarn, it would be more costlier, and therefore the cost of the final resultant doubled yarn would increase. So these are the two reasons why a doubled yarn would be more expensive than a singles yarn. So with this, we come to the end of today's lecture on doubling. Thank you.